time has come.
Welcome.
This is the weekly radio show, the Garifuna Language and Culture Academy Online, with Dr. Theodore Aranda, and we are doing lecture number 4 tonight, March 9th, 2016. So we're going to play the introduction to the show, and then we're going to get right into the lecture. Thank you so much for being with us. Please pass the word. Let people know that we are live with our lecture number 4 on the Garifuna history with Dr. Theodore Aranda, all the way from Dangriga in Belize, Central America. Here we go. This is the introduction. Garifuna American Heritage Foundation United proudly presents the Clifford J. Palacio Garifuna Language and Culture Academy Online. It's every Wednesday at 7 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, through www.lmbroots.com in the Bronx, New York, and www.radiocentroamerica.com in Los Angeles. Classes are free and for the entire family. Download the homework or handout from Facebook's Garifuna Language and Culture Academy page or from www.garifunaheritagefoundation.org. All radio programs will be recorded and archived on YouTube's GAHFU channel for on-demand listening. This project is made possible in part by a grant from the Alliance for California Traditional Arts in partnership with the Walter and Elise Haas Fund and the William and Flora Hewitt and the James Irvine Foundation. All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome tonight. We are very excited again to have Dr. Theodore Palacio live on the line with us in every week for the past 4 weeks. Tonight is lecture number 4, and he's going to be talking about, of course, the history of the Garifuna. We have the handout right on our Facebook page. If you want to download it, it's available on the Garifuna Language and Culture Academy Facebook page, and also on the GAHFU Garifuna page. So, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to welcome Dr. Theodore Aranda tonight for lecture number 4.
Buti buño, surusia, ida binya.
Buti buño, Yuani. Arase dina, wubarogo.
All right. Let's get started then. Seremen.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This is Dr. Theodore Aranda from Belize. And because of the fact that we have gotten so many questions or comments or whatever, trying to stress the fact that the Garinagu are a mixed people, I'm going to go over this part of our culture and our lecture so that at least we can get a few more things straight. But before I do that, here is a letter, a very brief one from a young man, Angel Valerio. And he said that he wants to go make a trip to Africa and to ask, and he asked what country he might visit to find either trace or some sort of a connection between himself and Garinagu. That's a very, very valid and good question for us, because the Garifuna and the Africa to America Park intends to build a link that is a communication line between ourselves from here and the people of Gambia. Gambia is a country northwest of Africa. The people there are a Mandinka people. And as I have said before, we are a Mandinga people also. Mandinga Karakoli, we and they are the Mandinka people. The same set of people that traveled from the Olduvai Gorge right down to the Pacific Ocean. The only thing is that they are still on the other side of the Atlantic Ocean, and we are on the other side of Atlantic Ocean, but we are going to build an alliance with them, and the alliance is basically to find out and go visit with them, and they visit with us to see what cultural and similarities continue existing. Like, for instance, like the ceremonies, like the beliefs, the morality, things that are basic to Garifuna people. And we too are going to want to communicate and be with them and be align ourselves with them, because we do want to hear at least a little bit of Mandinga. I know that after a few hundred years, the language changed. We don't speak Mandinga, and we don't speak Mande. They are the Mandinka people, and I just believe that they speak the Mande language. So that's a valid question, and the country is Gambia. But it will not just be enough for you to visit Gambia. You will have to visit a few more. There is Senegal close by. There's Ghana, Gambia there. There's New Guinea. It would be a good idea for you to visit Ghana if you can. And go to Nigeria also if you can. They are not exactly, all of them, let's say for instance the Igbo and the Yoruba tribe of Nigeria, or the Fulani of Ghana. They are not exactly, what you call, of the Garifuna origin, or that we are of their origin. The thing is that they were, Nigeria was one, Ghana was another one, New Guinea is another one. All of that area was a part of the Mali Empire, the empire that Abubakari used, the empire of which Abubakari was the emperor, when they traveled from Mali itself down into the Caribbean, and into Mexico. So that would be a good area for you to visit. Now, there is another question. And sometimes you don't know where people come up with questions like this. Here is one. This is from one Pablo Lambe. He is saying that according to my hypothesis, Garifuna was a trade language. What the heck does that mean? What do you mean by saying I am saying that Garifuna is a trade language? I didn't say that, neither do I mean it. Garifuna language is a full-blown language. It has its religious part, it has its trade part, it has its social meanings. I didn't say that. So that is one of the mistaken ideas that people carry about what you say and what you did not say. Mr. Lambe and Mr. Blanco, I did not say that Garifuna is a trade language, and I don't see where you could have arrived at that conclusion from what I have been saying. Number three, the other question comes from a lady, Sharon Williams, and she's saying that she doesn't agree with me and that language doesn't define us. All right. That's another one. I don't hear hear anybody say that the Garifuna language defines us. If you don't have an access to the handbook that I wrote, the Africa to America Park, on page 11, I'll just read to you something that I've said before, and I'm just going to try to repeat again.
I'm going to post it right now, Sorusia. I'm going to post page 11 on the Garifuna Language and Culture Academy page on Facebook.
Go to page 12, Ronnie. Go to page 12 and the middle of the section.
Okay. I will.
Page 12, middle of the section. Are we ready with that?
Yes, I'm just posting it right now, so we're ready.
Okay. In the middle of that paragraph, in the middle of that page, and in bold letters, I have that for thousands and thousands of years, where the Garifuna people traveled from the Aduvai Gorge to the east of Africa, right to all the way to the Atlantic Ocean. During those thousands and thousands and thousands of years, the Garifuna people went through and adapted to new environments, so that environment helped develop and establish what those people were and what they continue to be. Number two, because of that same migration thing, we evolved an identity. An identity means that you look like someone from this area, you sound like someone in that area, you behave like somebody from that area. Just like, for instance, I don't know if you are from Belize or if you are from wherever, but let's call you an American for the moment, United States of America. You can identify an American not simply because of the fact that he speaks English. it's more so the customs that he had, the way he has, what he believes, what he thinks, how he takes things, how he accepts it, the values that are significant to him, the things that he fights for, the things that he believes in. So it's not just a language. The fact that he speaks the language doesn't make him an American. British people speak English. Belizeans speak English. Jamaicans speak English. Australians speak English. And that language doesn't make us Australian, Belizean, European, or American. Language alone does not define you. And I did not say that either. Number three, you establish a heritage. Heritage is what you learn from your ancestors, what you learn from your parents, what you learn from your grandparents, your cousins, etc., neighbors, the people within your own area, your own country for that matter, affects the heritage that you have. The fourth one is you establish a culture. A culture are the things that you learn from your parents. If you go to school, you are going to learn the culture of the place where you go to school by virtue of the fact that culture is created by language is one of them, your belief is another one, your attitude is another one, the things that you value is another one. Those are all factors of the culture. And you develop into a specific people. All of those factors make you what you are, regardless of what language you speak, regardless of what place you live in, regardless of whatever you are. Those are the factors that make you what you are. And you will be identified, you will be known, you will be heard, and you will be understood, and you will be believed because of the things that have identified you. So to say to me that I am saying that language identifies you, you just didn't get it. I did not say that. Because there are very many things that define the Garifuna language, Garifuna people, besides the language. Language is a significant part of it, but not the only part. And I will repeat that. The language is a significant part, but not the only part of it. You are much, much more than whether your language or the food you eat or the place you live in. All of those define you. And there is another thing I believe is very, very, very important. Too many times, and I have seen that over and over again, that our people attack a person because a person doesn't speak a language. Let's say, for instance, because a person doesn't speak Garifuna, they want to tell you that you are not Garifuna. I've seen that and I've heard that over and over again from people. So, and especially those of us who don't speak Garifuna, those who don't speak the language Garifuna, are offended by that statement because of the fact that that's a weakness that they grew up with or that they have to live with, the fact that they don't speak the language. But please don't think that because you cannot speak the language, you are not a Garifuna. I know a lot of people who are not Garinagu, but are more Garifuna than very many of us who are Garinagu. So that's one of the things I thought we should sort of set aside now and stop it. Then there's a portion that she says, the fact that language, as you indicated, originates in the Amazon basin, I didn't say that. So please don't speculate that I am attacking indigenous people. No. I am not an indigenous individual. I'm grateful. I am African. I am not Arawak. I'm not Chinese. And there is no offense. There is no harsh feeling about those people who are not what I am. Or that I should be offended by the fact that they don't accept me for what I am. So there is a lot of misunderstanding here. I don't know where these question comments come from, but I don't know. I just don't know where they come from. Now, this fourth one is a rather, it's a dandy. The question is, what words in Garifuna are Mande? I don't know. I don't speak Mande. The language I speak is Garifuna, not Mande. Garifuna is an offshoot of Mande. What I'm saying is, what that means is, Garifuna evolved from a larger group of people, larger ethnic group, larger tribe, if you want to use the word, that is Mandinga or Mande. Garifuna is an offshoot of the offshoot of that simply means that at one, I mean, your ancestors far in the back were Mande people. But I don't know, neither can I answer you. I don't know if where the question comes from. What was in Garifuna Mande? I don't know. I don't speak Mande. And even if you pronounce the word to me in Mande, I do not even understand it. Even if you say it in good, I mean, even if you try to speak Garifuna, but if you speak with a Mande accent, I just may not be able to understand it. So I don't know. Simple and straight. And the other question, the part of that question is, what the next question might be, basically, what words in Garifuna, in Garifuna are carried? And it's the same person, Pablo Blanco, that asks those questions. So I said it some time ago, I said last week, I think, that I cannot tell you, Arawak, for instance, I don't know a word in Arawak. I don't know a word in Carib. I don't know a word in Mande. I am not Carib. I am not Arawak. I am not a Mandinka person from 1300 or before that. I am now living in 2016, more than 400 years behind those periods. So the fact that I don't speak Mande doesn't mean that that Garifuna is not an offshoot of Mande. I don't know where that question comes from. And I don't quite understand what it means much higher. To tell me that what words in Garifuna and Mande and what the language of this book was the other question. I don't know if the person is being trying to be vicious or trying to be funny. I don't know. I write in English because it's the only language I can deal with to write. I understand Garifuna. I understand Spanish. But I don't write in Garifuna. I don't write much in Spanish either. So the question seems to mean to me, I don't know if this is what the man means or if this is what Mr. Blanco means, that if you cannot write in a language, it's because you don't understand it. Let's go back a bit. Roman was an empire. And from the Roman language for that matter, from Latin sprang about four offshoots. One is Italian, the other is French, the other is Spanish, and the other is Portuguese. Now, I can understand Portuguese if you go slowly, because I speak Spanish. Oh, I understand Spanish, but I'm not a Spaniard. I'm Garifuna, but I do speak Spanish. If you go slowly, well, in Portuguese you can speak even faster because Portuguese is a lot more similar to Spanish. Spanish I understand perfectly. French, I don't understand French if you speak to me even slowly. But they are all Roman language. They sprung from the main origin Latin. So I don't know if he is saying that if you cannot write in English, it's because you understand English, or if you don't understand English, that if you cannot understand in Arabic, if you cannot understand Arabic, that, or if you are going to be talking about Arabic, you ought to understand Arabic. You ought to know Arabic. Well, many of the origin of our words is Arabic. Much of it is African. But again, Africa is a huge, huge continent. Don't forget that, please. It's the second largest continent on Earth. Okay? So, that's another question that I believe springs from a very, very serious misunderstanding. Here's one. Another one, rather. I know we came from Africa, and there are a lot of tribes in Africa. What tribe from Africa are the Garifuna descendants from? I thought I had answered that question over and over and over and over again. We are a Mandinga people. Mandinga is of African descent. That's from where we descended. And he asked for, is it the Igbo tribe? Igbo, no. Igbo is another... please don't forget this, what I'm going to say to you. The continent of Africa has more than 5,000 languages. Let me repeat. The continent of Africa is a huge continent, and it speaks more than 5,000 languages. Now, if you are trying to imply, if Garifuna is Igbo, I don't know why you should assume that. Let's go back to now. Igbo, you find Igbo in Nigeria. In Nigeria alone, I think there are more than 53 languages. In Nigeria alone, I think they have more than 53 languages. I know a lot of Nigerians. I was in Nigeria for about 15 times already. I've been to Nigeria. I can't even speak any of the languages because, I don't know. Many Nigerians do not understand one another because there are 53 languages, and most likely you are not going to be able to speak 53 languages, even though you come from one single state of Nigeria. I have a friend who is a physician, and his wife is from another tribe. They can't speak to each other in their own language. He can't speak to her in his language. She can't speak to him in her language. So they speak English. So those are some of the things that if you start listening to what I'm trying to say to you, I think we'd go far. And the other thing, I'm going to stop there because I don't think it does us any good to continue into discourse like that when that was not the topic of the discussions in the first place. So I think I'll stop at that. But one thing I can say to you is this booklet is about the journey of the Garifuna person. And I want that to be understood very, very well. This handbook is about the journey and the identity of the Garifuna person. Now, let's get to the lecture of tonight. And all of this is going to be basically to try to tell you that Garifuna is an independent, integrated language. There are two accounts that relate the crossing of the Atlantic from the Old World. When I say Old World, I'm talking about Africa, Europe, and Asia. Those two accounts, because we were taught in school that Columbus discovered America, and Columbus was supposedly the first one to get to the Americas. Okay, let's take a look at that. First of all, the African people from Northwest Africa accidentally, I believe, hit a current called the Mid-Atlantic Drift or the Mid-Atlantic Current. There's a northern one and there's a southern one. During that period of time, and more than 10,000 years BC, that is 8,000 years ago, for more than 8,000 years ago, our ancestors from Africa had been traveling between West Africa and the Americas. And when I say Americas, I mean the Caribbean, South America, North America. They had been traveling that route, but it was not very well known about, because again, the Europeans wouldn't write about that for very many reasons. But in it was between two expeditions. The first expedition was about 1305, and the second expedition was about roughly between 1307 and 1312, somewhere around there. But let's cut that in the middle and just say 1310. When Abubakari made this trip, that trip is recorded. There is a history of that trip. There are writings about that trip. So there are enough evidence about that trip. So, I mean, Abubakari II, therefore, led a delegation or led a group of people. Two trips he made. And in total, he had about 2,400 ships. That was an emperor, the richest emperor of the world at that time. Abubakari II, therefore, crossed the Atlantic. And he carried in his boats on that trip some of our Garifuna ancestors. The reason for Abubakari taking those people at that time was that they were very good seamen, they were very good sailors, they were very good boat people, and they were very good traders. And Abubakari II crossed the Atlantic to go to the North Pole, to the Americas, because he knew from those people who had crossed the Atlantic, that there are people on the other side of the ocean. And it would be a very, very good thing for them to trade with them. And they did. And it was very, very profitable. That's the first account. I mean, and we'll come back to that a little later. The second account is that in 1492, 185 years afterwards, one Christopher Columbus, a white man from Europe, crossed the Atlantic by following the route of the Africans. Christopher Columbus got all his information from the Africans to cross the Atlantic and to also reap some of the benefits of that business, of that trade, of that commerce. Now, I want you to hear this, because this way I'm going after those of you who still want to argue with me about Garinagu being Arawaks or Caribs. When Abubakari crossed the Atlantic, he did not cross it with a mixed people from Africa. There are no Indians, or there are no American natives in Africa. Not at that time, there were none. So Abubakari did not cross the Atlantic with a mixed people. Number one, there were no Native Americans in Africa. They just weren't any. That third one is, Abubakari II did not find a mixed African people in America. Let's go back to it. He did not sail with the mixed people. He sailed with Africans, all of them. He did not meet mixed people on the road, on the route. The people he took along were Africans, not mixed people. That's one. The second part to it, therefore, is the black Africans that were there for more than 6,000 years were not mixed. Now, Christopher Columbus, and I want this to be heard also, Christopher Columbus did not take along mixed Arawaks from the American, from the Europe, from the old world. He did not take along people that were Africans mixed with Arawaks, mixed with Caribs. Christopher Columbus did not. When Christopher Columbus got to the Americas, what he found there were two sets of people. And again, maybe I shouldn't use the word Americas, because he was talking mostly about what today we call Caribbean. when Christopher Columbus got to the Caribbean, he found two distinct people. One black, the other one Native American. The black people are those that have been traveling for a long, long time before Columbus took his voyage. But when he got there, he didn't find Christopher Columbus, that is, did not find a mixed people. Now, the reason for my going to go after this for you is we want to believe that whatever the Englishman writes, whatever the European writes, is true and correct. Now, I'm going to use the very evidence that you are using to arrive at a wrong answer. Christopher Columbus did not take along, neither did Christopher Columbus say that he found a mixed people in the Americas, even though Africans had been traveling to the Americas for more than 6,000 years. Columbus never said that. When Abubakari went to Yurumein, now let's talk about St. Vincent, because too many of us want to believe that St. Vincent is our mother home. When Abubakari arrived in 1310, more or less, into the Americas, which includes Yurumein, I repeat that. When Abubakari arrived in the Caribbean, which includes Yurumein, he did not go specifically to Yurumein. And he did not go to any specific area because he was trading. He moved around the area and he crossed that area from the Caribbean into to the coast of Mexico. And Christopher Columbus said in his own language that he found black people trading in gold. That was in Hispaniola to them in those days, but Haiti today. And whom he found there, that is Christopher Columbus speaking in his journal, in his annals of his travels, that he found two distinct people, black and red or yellowish, if you want to use that expression. What Christopher Columbus saw, and he reported, and he even sent example of the gold that he found there, he sent it to Spain to find out what the origin of that gold was. And the origin of that gold was New Guinea. That's on the African side of the Atlantic Ocean. Columbus did not speak about the mixed people because he didn't find any. That's another one. Let's go further to the other Europeans whose documented evidence are collected about blacks and the natives of the Americas. And I'm going to use the same document that you would believe and that you would take for with regard, without any hesitation at all. As long as the British say it, the French say it, the Spanish say it, it's true. Now let's challenge this piece here. The British Calendar of State, that's a paper in the British of those times, records, reports, stated and talked about the British Calendar of State paper stating that between 1661 and 1668 that he found only a few black slaves and a distinct Indian people separate from each other. That's what Christopher Columbus found in the Caribbean. That's what Christopher Columbus found in Haiti, in Yurumein, and the areas that he looked at. He found no mixed people. What he found there were separate people, one black, and those blacks, and listen to this, those blacks trading with those natives there. And that was why the blacks crossed the Atlantic Ocean to go trade. Next one is a missionary man by the name of Father René or Ramon. Father Ramon reported that when he landed in the Caribbean, when he landed in Yurumein, when he landed in St. Vincent, he found two distinct people, a black people and an Arawak, a yellow people. He said reddish yellow. Another one, Refinesque, is a linguist who also visited the area at that time and did some studies and analysis. He too found two separate people in the Caribbean. Don Juan, who king of Portugal at that time, Queen Isabella of Spain was the Spanish queen or royalty, and Don Juan, king of Portugal, was the royalty of Portugal, and he spoke about Africans crossing the Atlantic back and forth, doing trade and everything else. He never spoke, neither did he mention any mixed race or mixed people. Rodrigo de Colmenares and Vasco Núñez de Balboa of what at that time was Darien. They called it Darien at that time, but now we call it Panama. They surveyed the area, traveled it from side to side. They found two distinct people. That is their report. This is their report, and that is what you believe. Ferdinand Columbus, that is the son of Christopher Columbus, when he got to Honduras, the northeast of Honduras, he found a black people, Garinagu, in Honduras, long before Christopher Columbus. So Hondurans did not come from St. Vincent. St. Vincent was a separate place, Haiti was a separate place, but all of those places were places that our Garifuna people traded in. And that's a fact. Now, my question to you then is, with all of these people, the very people you would believe, if all of them say that they found no mixed people in those areas, and that they found separate people, one black and another white, another yellow or red, if you can believe that white people are telling the truth, why are you still saying to me that the people they found there were mixed? They were not. They were separated people. They were separate people. Distinct in their own fashion and living their own lives. Christopher Columbus never said that he found any people that were other than those two people, the yellow or the red and the black. All of those that came after him, closely after him, found separate people, black and red. Now, let's continue for a little while. What I did was research what was taught to me in school, because there were quite a few things about it that I just couldn't quite fathom, and I just couldn't quite look into. Science and research, let me repeat, science, if you're talking scientifically, and research, you are talking about looking up things, use two or three methods. There are very many of course, but you can put all of them together and make them more or less three. Science and research uses the method of analyzing something. When you are given something to believe in or to teach one of the things that science, I'm talking about science, I'm not talking about religion. Science uses the methods of analyzing, one, observing, that is looking for himself or looking at things for themselves, and reasoning. And listen to this again. Science uses science, analysis and research using science, research for analyzing, observing, and reasoning about what exists. Science observes what exists. Science analyzing what exists. Reason analyzes what exists. Whether you are talking about trees, you are talking about water, or you are talking about the air, you are talking about fish, you are talking about human beings or people, or you are talking about diseases or any other thing, you examine, you analyze, you observe, and you examine the reason about what exists. Science or history are not about what does not exist. I'll repeat. Science and history are not about what does not exist. These people use a scientific method to analyze what they found, what they saw, what they observed, not what they make up. Because Christopher Columbus, as I said to you, did not say that, does not say that, his son doesn't, etc. But yet, you are talking about a group of people that were supposed to have been mixed, and you call them Garifuna. And the ancestors were supposed to have been, Arawak is one, African is the other one, and Carib is the other one. You end up with Garifuna. Now, when you are shown a Garifuna, when you are dealing with Garifuna, you want to call it something else, I don't know, but you can't, are you suggesting to me that we Garifuna, those in Honduras, those here in Belize, those in the United States, those in Labugo, etc., we speak our language, have our culture, do our history, and do our traveling and from Aldivar God right across Africa into the Americas today. We speak, we are one, and you want to tell us that we are mixed? Take a good look at that. There may be people, yes, who are mixed. Of course there are. There are people who are mixed. And mixed people, therefore, do exist. Mixed people do exist. But Garifuna and the Garifuna people, the Garinagu, are not one of them. Now, this is the crunch. Don't come to me with somebody who is not a Garifuna and tell me that that person makes up the Garifuna language. My research is intended to document evidence about Garinagu. My research sent me to find out about the Garifuna people, not about those who are not. So don't ask me about Africans. I mean about the Arawaks. I don't know Arawaks. And I did not study Arawaks. Don't ask me about about Caribs. I didn't analyze Caribs. I don't know Caribs. And I'm not writing about Caribs. We are a Mandinga Caracola people, offshoot of those African people. And we, the Garifuna people, are the African people by name. We named ourselves Garifuna or Garinagu because we traded in gold. And the word Garifuna means those who trade in gold. We are an African people, but were distinguished from the rest because of our culture, our tradition, our heritage, and our language. We are a Garifuna people because we are the descendants of those people. And by all rights and whatever, legal or otherwise, we are their descendants. They called themselves Garifuna, or in the plural, Garinagu. We too are Garinagu. We are Garifuna, a Mandinga Karakole offshoot of people, not a mixed people with others. We are those, our descendants of our ancestors who trafficked in gold. Rani?
Yes.
I would like to stop here. I may want to make just one more statement so that we can open the forum for discussion if there are those who would like to discuss it further. What I am trying to do with my research is to develop a Garifuna archive. A Garifuna archive is a place to which you can go to find information about Garifuna people. This archive, this museum, this analysis, this reading is about those who are Garifuna people, not about those who are not Garifuna. My research is to develop the evidence and the documents about Garinagu, not about those who are not. The documents and evidence of Garifuna or the Garinagu are not those of the non-Garifuna, close and similar they may look. We need our museum. We need our archive. We need our findings to explain ourselves so that we can rely on our own evidence, rely on what we know and what we see, not what others believe about us, not what others say about us, or not what others write about us. I am Garifuna because my mother, father, grandparents, as far back as we can go, are Garinagu. I am Garifuna because of the culture that I have, language, etc., and my history. I am Garifuna because in the Garifuna language, if you ask any Garifuna anywhere and ask him in Garifuna, Katabusa, and the translation for that is, what are you? You will find no Garifuna anywhere that will answer to you other than Garifuna Au. Because that is the answer. You won't hear a Garifuna tell you Arawak Au. Otherwise, he just doesn't know what he's talking about. And he's not going to tell you Carib Au. As a matter of fact, if he didn't know, he could carry no Garifuna. If he didn't know. I don't know what Arawak is in Garifuna either. I don't know. I'm not saying that it doesn't exist. I just don't know.
Right.
Because I speak Garifuna. I understand Garifuna. And that's what I am. You may call me anything else. You may call me a Arawak. You may call me a Chinese. But there is a song that says, Abubakariii Garifuna. Run,
yes,
pick it up.
Yes, Surusia, very nice lecture. One thing that I'd like to maybe ask you, and
yes,
this
please.
Is for the fact that I have been listening to, you know, I love Garifuna music. I have a very large collection, but I've heard many songs in Garifuna that talk about Yurumein.
Yes.
I mean, these are ancient songs. These are songs that are over 200 years old, and they mention Yurumein. So what is the connection there? Why do they keep going back to the so-called homeland?
Because that's what we thought some time ago. especially during, it's one of the research that I'm doing right now. I'm starting to work on it, and we are going to continue it. Some of our ancestors, and I repeat the word some of our ancestors, because of the trading, used Yurumein as a trading post. Trading mm-hmm. post simply means that's where you would come with the stocks, and from there you spread it. Just like a, like today, crates, or you can buy things from China, you can buy things from England, you can buy, and you ship it across. That's what our ancestors did. They traded. Now, that's one, but Yurumein was one of the areas that they used. Not the most area. They were trading from Haiti, Santo, what today are Haiti, Santo Domingo, St. Lucia, Trinidad, Venezuela, Panama, Honduras. But because of the attacks by the British against the Garifuna people, massacring them, killing them, and they expelled them from their home country or from the trading post, let's put it that way, to Honduras. We are not from Yurumein originally. We are from Africa. So we are not from Yurumein, after all. But because of that shipment, or because of that expulsion, and they expelled some of our people to what today is Honduras. By the time those people got to Honduras, they found Garinagu in Honduras, the northeast Vietnamese section of Honduras, Trujillo, Ceiba, etc. Garinagu were there. But it's not that all the Garifuna people came from Yurumein. No. As I've said, Haiti and all of those places. And there's a trade post. But we originate. In other words, we did not originate in Yurumein. We originate in Africa.
Okay, but there's a question here.
Has always been a traveler, trader, explorer, and they move about. Go ahead.
Yes, there's a question from David Caballero, and the question is, are people converted to Catholicism once Garifuna arrived to Honduras? Hence, is the reason why most of us carry Spanish last names prior to our arrival to Central America. And then he says, we have French names as well as Spanish names. According to the book Sojourners of the Caribbean by Nancy Gonzalez.
Is that the question?
Yes.
I have read not just Nancy Gonzalez. I've read quite a lot of people who are absolutely wrong. Absolutely. They may be, archaeologists. I'm not saying no. The question I'm asking, where do they get the information from? It's not so much what you believe or what you find in the archive. Let's go back to the Garifuna language again. Let's go back to Garifuna for a while. If you understand the Garifuna, there are very many things you don't need to be said, to be told about it being wrong when they say that Christians existed before Digul, before Mali, and before our morals. It's not easy for you to it's not difficult for you to dismiss that claim. When you go to the Basilica of Rome, in Rome, I have been there at least some 5-6 times, and you see the Madonna and the Child, which is one of the very prettiest and most significant pictures in the Basilica of Rome. But when you see the Madonna, the African Madonna, Madonna and the Child, there's no way at all that you can believe that Africa, our version of it, is much older than the Christian. So there are very many things that if you know your own heritage, like for instance, as I said to you in Digul, or when I said to you in Mali, If you know what Mali is, when you go to any Catholic church, you will see every single evidence in the church to be the Mali, to be from the Degu. If you know Degu, and you run into and you go to the Catholic Church in particular, or any other language for that matter, you'll find evidence to the fact that the Degu, the Mali, are older. Let's put it into a biological situation. When a child resembles the Arawak, we never say, let's put it that way, we never say that a parent resembles her children. Let me repeat. Mm-hmm. You don't say that parents resemble the child.
Right.
It's the other way around. It's the child that resembles his parents.
Correct. Mm-hmm.
So, very many of these things, for some reason we want to think that we get these things from the Europeans. No, it's the other way around. They get it from us. We civilized Greece. We civilized the Romans. We civilized the British. We civilized the French. We civilized the Spanish. And if your name happens to be a Spanish name, let me repeat it because I said it last week. If your name happens to be a Spanish name, most likely it was during the time when the Africans colonized Spain for 800 years. Let me repeat that. When the Moors, those are Africans, colonized Spain for 800 years, that was most likely the time that those names was given from the Africans to the Spaniards. So by the time the Spaniards came down here, they came down with those names, not because they were the original names, but they were the names that were given to them by the African conquerors. But you have to know, this is one of the reasons that I'm doing this. What you need to do most of the time is research the origin of your name. I did that.
Thank you.
The word Aranda, I used to be told in school that that's a Spanish name. Well, I didn't know any better, and I didn't quite argue about it either. I went to Zimbabwe, I went to Nigeria. In Nigeria alone, there are four or five versions of the same name Aranda. There's the Aranda, there is the Atanda with a T, there is the Avanda with a V, and there is, I think it's Azanda with a Z. Those are all Nigerian names. The Nigerians did not come to Spain, neither did they come to Belize to get their names.
Mm-hmm.
We are the ones who descend from them with our names, their names. So yes, it's basically most of the time because whatever we were told seems to want to ring a bell. Like, I think you asked the question last week, or somebody asked you the question last week, you speak about Africanized Garifun.
Yes.
Africanized Garifun, my foot. Garifun is African.
Yes.
It's
yes.
Not an Africanized anything. It's Garifun is African. And we have gone through that today.
Thank you, Doctor, for a wonderful lecture. I want to send a big shout out to our wonderful listeners in La Boca, Livingston. We have Celso Neri listening along with Miss Eva Moore at the Wamilitu, Luba Furende Wamilitu, Garifuna School in La Boca, Livingston. So a big shout out to them for tuning in tonight. A wonderful people all the way in Texas, in Katy, Texas, Pasadena, Brooklyn, the Bronx, Seaford, New York, and many, many other places. We have a full house tonight. Thank you so much for listening. A wonderful audience. And don't forget to please send us your questions. The questions could be posted on our Facebook page, Garifuna Language and Culture Academy Online. We are on Facebook as GAHFU Garifuna, and under GAHFU Garifuna, we have
the public group called Garifuna Language and Culture Academy. You could send the questions for Dr. Aranda via email as well. The email is GarifunaHeritageFoundation@yahoo.com. One more time, GarifunaHeritageFoundation@yahoo.com. Or you could simply post your questions on Facebook under GAHFU Garifuna or the Garifuna Language and Culture Academy public page that we have on and very active tonight. So thank you, Dr. Aranda, for a wonderful lecture. It's been 1 hour, wonderful information. Is there anything else you would like to leave us with?
The thing is to be ready for next week because we are halfway into our lecture.
Yes.
But there are quite a few other things that we will have to touch along the way. I don't want to upstage any of the activities that we are doing. What we are trying to do now, though, a group of us who are trying to push the idea of our own Garifuna people, we are trying to develop an alliance. In other words, we discuss our issues, we talk about our issues, and we study our issues so that we can arrive at adequate and truthful conclusion about ourselves. We are going to continue it, and that's the purpose to this discussion. The purpose is to allow us to enlighten our people. There is an African statement, and now that's what I'm going to end with. Those who know that they do not know, you can teach. Those who know, or those who don't know that they do not know, you better leave alone. With that, Ronnie, I stop for tonight.
Thank you very much, Dr. Aranda. It's been a wonderful lecture. Good night, and we'll see you next Wednesday again right here at www.radiocentroamerica.com and HTTP. Let me just say it in simple words. www.lmbroots.com radio in the Boogie Down Bronx in New York. Thank you so much, and good night. Dr. Aranda, we love you, and we'll see you next week. Ayo.
Okay, we'll do a while.
Okay, bye-bye.
Hola mi seluma, hola mi seluma ma, bayanu hanuma.
On behalf of Garifuna America Heritage Foundation, we thank you for joining us tonight to the Clifford J. Palacio Garifuna Language and Culture Academy online. Don't forget, tune in every Wednesday at 7 p.m. Pacific Standard Time and 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time through www.lmbroots.com in the Bronx and www.radiocentroamerica.com in Los Angeles. Classes are free and for the entire family. Download the homework or the handout from our Facebook's Garifuna Language and Culture Academy page or from www.garifunaheritagefoundation.org. All radio shows are recorded or archived for your online demand. So you can find it on YouTube's GAHFU channel anytime 24/7. This project is made possible in part by a grant from the Alliance for California Traditional Arts in partnership with the Walter and Elise Haas Fund, the William and Flora Hewitt, and the James Irvine Foundation. Ika po mama, ika po tata.